the Lord, everybody. This is Pastor Anthony Menzel, and we are greeting you in the name of Jesus Christ from Abundant Love Christian Church here in Northern New Jersey. Hallelujah. And as has become our custom, we are pre-taping our English service, but we do invite you to please join us for Spanish worship at 12 o'clock. We have on our website, abundantlovechurch.us, a bilingual hymnal, so you can go and look at what the words are for the Spanish songs that we sing. And we just ask you, when we're singing, when we're worshiping the Lord, that you join in. And this is not just a videotape. This is not a show. This is the actual service. Hallelujah. So whenever, regardless of whenever you're watching this taping, please stand up for the worship and as you are able, and just raise your hands to the Lord and sing to the Lord. Amen. We also have an English hymnal at abundantlovechurch.us. Before I have Reverend Mary open us in prayer, I also want to just reiterate, God willing, this week we will have a Google Meet approximately 3 o'clock in the afternoon, where you can come and join us for teleconference prayer. Hallelujah. So everybody will get together via Google Meet, and that link will be posted here on our Facebook page. So hopefully as many of you as possible will be able to join us for that as well. And I just praise the Lord that we're able to do another service for the glory of the Lord Jesus. Now, Reverend Mary, if she could come and pray for the service. Because we never want to do anything without the blessing of the Lord Jesus. Amen.
Father God, in the name of Jesus, I come to your presence, Lord, so you could bless this service, Jesus. That everything that we do will please you. That everybody that's listening will be blessed by you. And Lord Jesus of Nazareth, I claim in faith that if you are with us, who could be against us? Bless everything that's going to happen today, Lord. Bless everybody that's going to participate. And most of all, Jesus, be with us in everything that we do in this service, because we do it for your glory only. And in your precious name, Jesus of Nazareth, I claim it. Amen and hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Praise the Lord. So now we are going to have our worship team come and bless us with some selections. Amen. To get our spirits ready, our souls ready to receive the word of God. Okay, hang on.
What's his name?
Jesus.
What's his name?
Jesus.
What's his name?
Jesus.
What's his name?
Jesus.
King of the kings.
Jesus.
Lord of lords.
Jesus.
Prince of peace.
Jesus.
Mighty God.
Jesus.
What's his name?
Jesus.
What's his name?
Jesus.
Watch his name.
Jesus.
Watch his name.
Jesus.
My best friend.
Jesus.
My first love.
Jesus.
My Savior.
Jesus.
My Lord.
Jesus.
Watch his name.
Jesus.
Watch his name.
Jesus.
Watch his name.
Jesus.
Watch his name. My healing.
My healer,
my provider,
Jesus.
My life guide,
Jesus.
My deliverer,
Jesus.
What's his name?
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 Jesus.
Amen.
Hey, very nice.
No se vaya, Gaby, falta una.
Pero quiero a mi papi.
Ah, pues yo voy también.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, to break every chain, to break every chain. There's an army racing on.
There's an army racing on. There's an army racing on.
To
break every chain, to break every chain, to break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
To break
every chain, to break every chain, to break every chain.
There's an
army rising up. There is an army rising up. There's an army rising up.
To
break every chain, to break every chain, to break every chain.
There's a power in the name of Jesus.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
To
break every chain,
to
break every chain, to break every chain.
Gabriela,
¿quieres cantar What's His Name, pero que tú lo empieces?
Nosotros no, 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 nosotros, tú dices y nosotros
no
decimos
quiero,
Jesús.
No quiero.
¿No quieres? Ok.
Y nosotros decimos Jesús, qué grande lo hiciste, tan lindo.
Ah.
En el arte lo hiciste lindo.
No. Ok. Gabriela did a beautiful job singing that song, What's His Name, but she was the one singing What's His Name instead of saying Jesus. Amen? So we're trying to convince her. She did it before the service. We're trying to convince her to do it now, but it's okay. Praise the Lord. I just want, and it's so important with our children, and it's something I'm going to talk about today. So important for our children to want to be in the things of the Lord. And for us to find a balance between encouraging them to be in the things of the Lord and letting them just be children and not making them not like church. Because if you push something too hard on somebody, sometimes they don't like it. And so we have to be very careful that we don't do that with our children. Amen? So I'm just going to pray. Father God, I pray you speak through me now. Hallelujah. I pray that everybody would be glad that they were in the service today, participating in this service. Hallelujah. Especially you, the Lord Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. I thank you for all these things. Holy Spirit, I thank you for your tongues. Hallelujah. But cover those things that we don't know with the understanding. Hallelujah. In Jesus Christ's name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Well, this week, I was texting with a friend, and we were talking about the extent of our, I guess my summary of it would be the extent to which we should be helping other people. What should be our priorities when it comes to helping other people? And out of that conversation, the Lord put on my heart this topic. I fell in my spirit, and then I prayed about it, and I felt confirmed by God to talk about this topic. And the topic, the title for today's message is, Prepare the Ark God Wants You to Prepare.
Hallelujah.
Prepare the Ark God Wants You to Prepare. So we're going to start talking about Noah. And I want to start in Genesis chapter 5, verse 9. So this is talking about some of Noah's ancestors. And it talks about Enosh lived 90 years and begot Canaan. After he begot Canaan, Enosh lived 815 years. We're going to see later on that the life expectancy for human beings was cut off when God got sick of how evil people were. But back in those times, people lived like 1,000 years almost. After he begot Canaan, Enosh lived 815 years and had sons and daughters. So all the days of Enosh were 905 years, and he died. So look at this. He starts having children at 90. Okay? That's important. And he had his first son, and then he had many other children. Canaan lived 70 years. So Canaan got an earlier start than Enosh having children and begot Mahalalel. After he begot Mahalalel, Canaan lived 840 years and had sons and daughters. So he had many children too. So all the days of Canaan were 910 years and he died. So we go to the next generation. Mahalalel lived 65 years and begot Jared. So he gets started even earlier than his father having children. After he begot Jared, Mahalalel lived 830 years and had sons and daughters. So he had a lot of children too. So all the days of Mahalalel were 895 years. And he died. Jared lived 162 years. So he gets a later start than some of his ancestors. And begot Enoch. After he begot Enoch, Jared lived 800 years. So, he lived a long time, had sons and daughters, he had a lot of children. So, all the days of Jared were 962 years, and he died. Enoch lived 65 years. So, Enoch gets an earlier start, and begot Methuselah. After he begot Methuselah, Enoch walked with God 300 years. Enoch was a special case. Enoch had a very close relationship with God. I preached a couple of weeks ago about how Enoch had a very special relationship with God, and he didn't even see death. That's not the point of our sermon today, but he walked with God 300 years. He actually had a shorter life than most of the people in those times because he had such a close relationship with God that God just took him. He just wanted Enoch to be with him. So sometimes when people are very close to God, sometimes they die younger than other people because God just wants them in heaven. So verse 22, after he begot Methuselah, Enoch walked with God 300 years and had sons and daughters. So he's having lots of children too, even though it's 300 years. Imagine all the children you can have in 300 years. So all the days of Enoch were 365 years, and Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. We learn in the book of Hebrews that Enoch was actually, he did not see death. He was just transposed. Methuselah lived 187 years. So he had a later start and begot Lamech. And after he begot Lamech, Methuselah lived 782 years and had sons and daughters. So all the days of Methuselah were 969 years and he died. So the oldest recorded person in the Bible is Methuselah. That's why people say that's as old as Methuselah. Amen? And he lived to be 969 years old. Lamech lived 182 years and had a son. So this son, and he called his name Noah, saying, "This one will comfort us concerning our work and the toil of our hands because of the ground which the Lord has cursed." So there was something special about Noah from his birth. After he begot Noah, Lamech lived 595 years and had sons and daughters. So listen to this. So all the days of Lamech were 777 years, and he died. And Noah was 500 years old. Look at the late start Noah got in terms of having children. Everybody else, nobody was older than 200 when they started having their children. Noah was 500 years old. So for some of us, myself included, I had my biological daughter. I have one biological daughter, one daughter who is my daughter because I'm raising her. But I have one biological daughter. I got a late start. Amen? I was like 41 when she was born. So for us who maybe you get a late start in an area and you think, well, you know, this was a late start. Maybe it was too late. I should have done something earlier in my life. Part of my life has passed me by, whatever it was. Just remember, Noah got started at 500 years old. And his other ancestors, it says they had sons and daughters. They had these huge families. Noah begot Shem, Ham, and Japheth. He had three children. That was it. So just imagine these other people, you're seeing all of these other people having tons and tons of children. All you have is three. For us in modern times, a lot of people have two kids or one kid or whatever. But back in the day, they had big families. And a lot of times your blessing was related to how many children you had. Like how blessed you were was how many children you had. So here you're looking at Noah. He's getting a late start and he only has three kids. So the issue is, though, you have to know that God has a plan for you. Hallelujah. And God knows what's best for you. And sometimes what's best for you, what's best for other people, isn't what is best for you. And that's why we could think about it from this perspective. I think that God knew that only Noah, his wife, and three more couples could fit on the ark with all the animals that were going to go in the ark. If he had had 100 children, they wouldn't have fit, potentially. So God knew, you can have three children, Noah, because that's what's going to fit on this ark. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 12, is very interesting. It says, therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. See, sometimes we think we can handle more. Hallelujah. Oh, the Lord is speaking to me right now. Sometimes we think we can handle more than what we can actually handle. And God is protecting us from getting too many things on our shoulders. So you think that you can handle it, but you really have to be careful. Take heed lest you fall. Verse 13, no temptation has overtaken you except such as common to man. But God is faithful, who will not let you to be tempted beyond what you are able. See, God's not going to put more on you than you can bear. That's where that saying comes from, this passage, I believe. That he will not let you be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape, that you may be able to bear it. Now, when we talk about making the ark, preparing the ark, God wants you to prepare. Folks, God gave Noah very specific instructions for making the ark. And you know, God only used Noah to save 8 people. Hallelujah. So maybe God's purpose for your life, and I've often talked about how God's plan is like a tapestry. And each one of us is like a string in the tapestry. And our role is not to do, you know, to make the whole tapestry. It's just to be our little part of the tapestry. And God knows best where our part of the tapestry should be put into the weaving room to make that tapestry. So when we think about Noah, and you think about, oh, my own life, well, who is God using me to reach? Are you being a light for your children? Are you being a light for your nieces and nephews? Are you being a light for your neighbors? Are you being a light for your friends? Are you being a light for that little corner of the world that God has put you in? Amen? So God gave Noah specific instructions for making the ark. It was only for 8 people. That's it. So maybe you're just there to reach your little corner of the world for Jesus. Genesis chapter 6, verse 1. Now it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth. So we have all these people living to be like 900 years old. They're having tons of children. Imagine if every 2 years you have a kid, that's 450 people, and all of those kids are having kids. You have a lot of people on the earth, more and more. And daughters were born to them, that the sons of God, so the fallen angels, the sons of God, those are fallen angels, those are demons, saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves of all whom they chose. So that's really wicked, right? An angel having relations with a woman, a human woman, and having children. And actually there are certain places in the world where they see that people have like different shaped skulls. One of them is in Paracas, Peru. The skulls are very large. They don't have the normal human dimensions. And they're, I mean, biblically, that is an indication that the kind of civilization was very advanced. That's an indication that that's coming from the mixture between angelic beings who were fallen angels, so they're demonic, with people. So you actually have some cultures, some societies that have had that mixture between people and demons. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not strive with man forever, for he is indeed flesh. So God got tired of it. People were so wicked. He said, I can't leave him to be alive until 900. And it says, yet his days shall be 120 years. That's why the oldest living people that we see are about 120 years old. Because God here, he said, that's it. Okay? 120 is the maximum lifespan for a human being. And there's scripture that talks about we're guaranteed 70 years, 80 years is like extra. And then we see here 120 years is basically the max. There were giants on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, and they bore children to them. So the sons of God is referring to the angels that were fallen angels that had relationships with the daughters of men, so with human women. Those were the mighty men who were of old, men of renown. Then the Lord saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil, continually. So there gets a point where God just, he sees that the people, no matter how much he tries to reach them, they refuse to get close to him. And at that point, it's like when the end of this world comes, and you read in Revelation that the people, all these plagues come and they don't repent, you know, then it's basically God doesn't have any recourse anymore. You know, it's like I feel like I see the world as like he's putting humanity through a strainer. And in that strainer, he's catching as many as possible to be saved. But there's going to come a point where nobody else is going to be able to be caught because the wickedness of humankind is going to be so great. That's how it was in the time of Noah. It's how evil people were. Verse 6, and the Lord was sorry. The Lord was sorry. He was sad that he had made man on the earth. And he was grieved in his heart. See, when we do the wrong thing, when we think the wrong thing, feel the wrong thing, say the wrong thing, we make God sad. And so the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast. So because we have a place of authority over the world, what we do as human beings, it affects the whole world. And we see that with the pollution, the destruction of the environment. God put Adam in the garden to tend it and keep it. He didn't put Adam in the garden to destroy it. Hallelujah. So creeping things and birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. See, humanity would have ended. If it weren't for Noah, humanity would have ended with the flood. But because of one person, humanity could be restarted. But I want to make it very clear, the people that he reached was his family. Noah wasn't there reaching a whole bunch of other people for God. He just reached his family. That was it. Then verse 9 says, this is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just man. So we know that Jesus said that there's nobody good but God, but he was a just man. He knew how to live right before God. Perfect in his generation. So this is somebody, I'm sure, who knew how to repent before God when he made mistakes, and he loved everybody, even when they weren't loving towards him. Noah walked with God. So when you get close to God in that relationship with him, that's when God is going to use you. And God will show you what kind of ark does he want you to make. Who's supposed to go in your ark? Hallelujah. And Noah begot three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence. So God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. The only person who was right, so this is a lot worse than what we see today. It's a lot of people trying to follow Jesus today with a good heart. Back in that time, there was one person, and that was Noah. And God said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them. And behold, I will destroy them with the earth. And then he goes into details. Prepare the ark that God wants you to prepare. Hallelujah. Make yourself an ark of gopher wood. Make rooms in the ark and cover it inside and out with pitch. He's telling him all of the instructions that he is supposed to follow. So it's not about us making our own ark. It's not that Noah's going to say, well, instead of pitch, I'm going to use this material. Or instead of gopher wood, I'm going to use this wood because I think it's better. We can't improve on God's plan. And this is how you shall make it. The length of the ark shall be 300 cubits. So there was a certain size that God knew would survive this great flood. And based on that size, there could only be four couples, Noah, his wife, and the three sons and their wives. That's it. Plus the animals. Its width 50 cubits and its height 30 cubits. You shall make a window for the ark. He didn't say two windows. He said a window. And you shall finish it to a cubit from above and set the door of the ark in its side. You shall make it with lower, second, and third decks. It didn't have four decks. It didn't have two decks. It had three decks. And behold, I myself am bringing floodwaters on the earth to destroy from under heaven all flesh in which is the breath of life. Everything that is on the earth shall die. But I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall go into the ark. Who's going in this ark? Hallelujah. Who's going in your ark? For Noah, it was you, your sons, your wife, and your sons' wives with you. Now, I'm going to be very clear. I don't want to say, oh, every big church is a bad church. But I believe sometimes God keeps churches small for a reason. My prayer for Abundant Love Christian Church is that everybody who comes to the church, that nobody would lack anything for being in our church. And so maybe the church is smaller than some other churches because if we were bigger, there'd be people who wouldn't be receiving all the things that they need to receive in the church. I also pray that everybody goes to heaven. So maybe if the church were bigger, we could minister to people's spiritual needs and some people would fall through the cracks. So this is the issue here. Prepare the ark, hallelujah, that God wants you to prepare. Say this too. When I first got saved, I thought that I had to share the gospel with everyone I met. I would try to give out tracts to every person with whom I had even minimal interaction. And I tell you, it was a lot of stress. Over time, God showed me that he wasn't sending me to every person. Scriptural support for this, Acts 16:6. Hallelujah. Now, when they had gone through Phrygia, imagine, these are apostles now. They're traveling on a missionary journey. And it says, when they had gone through Phrygia and the region of Galatia, they were forbidden by the Holy Spirit to preach the word in Asia. There was a whole region that God said no. Hallelujah. After they had come to Mysia, they tried to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit did not permit them. Another region that they were not supposed to go to. So passing by Mysia, they came down to Troas, and a vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia stood and pleaded with him, saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. So God knows who is ready for your ministry. And it's not everybody all the time. The Apostle Paul was not going to be received well in Phrygia. He's not going to be received well. Well, he's not going to be received well in Asia. He's not going to be received well in Bithynia. Hallelujah. I'm certainly not going to be received well by everybody in terms of ministry. So you have to wait for your Macedonia. You have to prepare the ark that God wants you to prepare. Now, after he had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go to Macedonia, concluding that the Lord had called us to preach the gospel to them. Hallelujah. One reason I believe that the Holy Spirit has us only minister to some people is so that we have the strength to minister to the people that are going to receive from our ministry. You know, if you're trying to minister to everybody and some people are not going to receive anything, you're going to spend a lot of your energy, and then when it's time to get to somebody who is going to receive, you may not have the energy, all the energy that they need for your ministry. For example, in Acts chapter 20, verse 7, on the first day of the week when the disciples came together to break bread, so this is Sunday, because remember, Sabbath was the end of the week for, Sabbath or Saturday was the end of the week for the Jewish people. So Jesus was resurrected on the first day of the week, on the Sunday. So now the disciples are coming together on Sundays. Paul, ready to depart the next day, spoke to them and continued his message until midnight. Imagine a sermon. Sometimes people get tired of a sermon that's like an hour long, right? He spoke hours and hours and hours because he knew that he wasn't going to see these people again. He spoke, he preached until midnight. And it says, there were many lamps in the upper room where they were gathered together. And in a window sat a certain young man named Eutychus, who was sinking into a deep sleep. So he's sitting in a window, this Eutychus. He's sitting there in the window. He was overcome by sleep. So he's fallen asleep in church. And as Paul continued speaking, Paul didn't stop just because some people were falling asleep. He continued speaking. He fell down from the third story and was taken up dead. So Eutychus died during the sermon. But Paul went down. He finally stopped preaching. Somebody had to die. Paul preached them until they were dead. But Paul went down, fell on him, and embracing him said, do not trouble yourselves, for his life is in him. Now when he had come up and had broken bread, so Paul is praying for him, right? He falls on this man, embraces him, and says, do not trouble yourselves, for his life is in him. Now when he had come up, had broken bread and eaten, and talked a long while, even until daybreak, he raises this guy from the dead, and he keeps preaching. So sometimes, and then he departed, and they brought the young man in alive, and they were not a little comforted. They saw the power of God raise somebody from the dead. And then Paul keeps preaching. Hallelujah. So there may be times when we have to minister for hours and engage in intense prayer. Think about the intensity of the prayer that Paul engaged in to raise that man from the dead. So we have to be strategic regarding using our energy in the ministry. Being strategic is very important to ensure that we truly fulfill God's mission for our lives. Matthew 7, what does it say? Matthew 7, 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. So you have to prepare the ark, hallelujah, that God wants you to prepare. Not your own ark with your own wood, your own size, but the ark God wants you to prepare. The people God wants you to reach out to. Verse 22, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? They tried to make an ark, but they didn't use the instructions that God gave them. Cast out demons in your name and done many wonders in your name. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. They didn't prepare the ark God wanted them to prepare. They prepared a different ark. So when we talk about Noah walking with God, Enoch walking with God, we have to walk with God. Paul walked with God, and the Spirit of God told him where to go and where not to go. And I'm not saying every time you go to run errands, the Holy Spirit is going to say, go to Walmart, don't go to ShopRite, or go to ShopRite, don't go to Walmart. I'm not saying that, but I'm saying there are certain times when the Holy Spirit is going to show you, yes, you need to say something about the Lord Jesus to this person. No, stop what you're doing right now and you know, do something else. This person's not going to receive. This person's going to receive. Do this ministry. Don't do that ministry. So, also have to say this. There are times when the Lord Jesus may not want us to engage in ministry-related activities at all. Psalm 127:1, what does it say? Unless the Lord builds the house, hallelujah, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. It is vain for you to, vain means it's purposeless, it's empty. It is vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows, for so he gives his beloved sleep. The Lord wants us to rest sometimes, so that we have the energy to minister to the people that he's really called us to. And I tell you right now, one of the main groups of people that God has called us to is our family. People in ministry, oftentimes, they minister to all the strangers, they minister in the street, but they don't minister to their own family. And I have a real issue with that. If I'm going to go, for example, if I'm going to go and try and help people in the church or help people in the community, but I've got people in my extended family, my nuclear family, or, you know, like my extended family, this time that I go, a special trip, to go see my mother-in-law or go see my oldest daughter's biological paternal grandmother. And I do that because I'm like, if I'm going to go help somebody that I don't even know, I'm not connected to, how am I not going to go and see this person that I am connected to? They better be more important to me than the person that I'm not even connected to as a family member. Doesn't make any sense. I'm going to go and help the homeless in the street, but I don't spend time with my mother-in-law. When she sees our grandchildren, it's like the biggest thing since sliced bread for her. I'm going to go and help and minister to somebody I don't know. And my oldest daughter's paternal biological grandmother needs something, and I don't go and bring it to her. It doesn't make any sense. So we got to prepare the ark that God wants us to prepare. And remember that we're only one person. The Lord Jesus is omnipresent. He's everywhere, all at the same time. Through the Holy Spirit, he's everywhere present. But you know what? I'm not everywhere present. I have to make the ark with the wood God wants me to make, the materials he wants me to make, with the number of decks he wants me to make, the size he wants me to make it. Talking about family, I want to go to Proverbs 17:6. We have to remember, one of the greatest treasures God gives us after our salvation is our descendants. Our spiritual descendants, yes, but especially our biological descendants, our adopted children, our biological children and grandchildren, those are treasures. Proverbs 17:6 says, children's children are the crown of old men. Your grandchildren are a crown. That's jewelry. And the glory of children is their father. So for fathers especially, we've got a special role in our children's life. We're the glory for them. It's like being their hero. What kind of hero as men are we? Are we a distant hero? So they, when they think about God the Father, they think, oh, this God is distant. He's not really interested in me. Or are we somebody who they fall down and you're there to put on a Band-Aid? They're crying, you scoop them up in your arms. So that they know, you know what, when I think of Father, I'm thinking of somebody who cares about me, who's interested in me. Our children, whether we're male, female, our children and grandchildren have to be a priority in our lives. If we don't make them a priority in our lives, the consequences can be dire. And you know, I know sometimes people don't have family, but God, it says in Psalms, God will put you in family. So whoever the people who are priority in your life are, hallelujah, whoever God gives you as a spiritual child, if you don't have biological children, it could be a niece, it could be a nephew, it could be a neighbor, whoever it is, amen, we have to make those people who look up to us a priority. They should be treasures in our lives. Proverbs 19:18. Listen to what this says. Chasten your son. Correct your son. Is what chasten is meaning. Chasten your son while there is hope. And do not set your heart on his destruction. If you don't correct your children, you are setting them up to be destroyed. You can't, you know, oh, I want to be their friend. You are not their friend. You can be friendly with them, but first and foremost, you're their parent. And then when they're doing the right thing, then you guys can be like friends. But first and foremost, you're the parent. I always say to my little one, Gabriela, I say, I'm Poppy, you're Googie. If she wants to do her own thing or want to be disobedient, she's not Poppy, I'm Poppy. And she understands that. And she does the right thing and obeys. Amen? And that kind of relationship, you try and build it up as early as possible, as early as they can understand. God can do a work even if they're older. You can pray and he'll bring them back home. And, you know, they say you can't make a twisted tree grow straight, but Jesus can do everything. Hallelujah. Amen. He can make a twisted tree grow straight. But it's much easier if you start when the tree's growing and just keep it straight.
Amen.
I want to talk about Lot. I want to talk about Abraham's nephew Lot and his family. And we know that Lot was saved by God because he was a righteous man, but his family was a mess. So Genesis chapter 13, verse 1. Then Abram, because this is before he had any children, so he was exalted father instead of the father of multitudes. God changed his name from Abram to Abraham because he, you know, when he was going to have his children. But Abram, he's still Abram, went up from Egypt, he and his wife and all that he had, and Lot with him to the south. So they're in southern Israel. Abram was very rich, what would become southern Israel. Abram was very rich in livestock and silver and gold. And he went on his journey from the south as far as Bethel, to the place where his tent had been at the beginning, between Bethel and Ai, to the place of the altar which he had made there at first. And there Abram called on the name of the Lord. Lot also, who went with Abram, had flocks and herds and tents. Now the land was not able to support them, that they might dwell together, for their possessions were so great that they could not dwell together. And there was strife between the herdsmen of Abram's livestock and the herdsmen of Lot's livestock. The Canaanites and the Perizzites then dwelt in the land. So Abram said to Lot, "Please let there be no strife between you and me, and between my herdsmen and your herdsmen, for we are brethren. Is not the whole land before you? Please separate from me. If you take the left, then I will go to the right, or if you go to the right, then I will go to the left." And Lot lifted his eyes and saw the plain of Jordan that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, like the garden of the Lord. Hallelujah. Like the land of Egypt as you go toward Zoar. Then Lot chose for himself all the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed east. Lot didn't consider. He just looked at the appearance. He didn't consider the spiritual health of the place he was going to. He didn't think about what type of people he was going to live with. I share from my own experience, my own heart, after seeing here in New Jersey how 70% of the voters, 70% of adults voting approved the legality, the legalization of marijuana. I don't know if it's going to be possible or not, but I'm going to do my best to send my youngest daughter to Christian school. Because it's not even about the children. It's about the parents. If the parents are supporting drug abuse and drug use, and I know from my own personal experience, from both sides, my wife's side of the family, my side of the family, how marijuana is a gateway drug that leads you to cocaine, to heroin, and to ruining your life forever. Because I know people close to me, they're still on methadone. They're still on other drugs that are given to them medically because heroin is such an addictive drug that to get off of it could be a whole week of being locked up and having physical symptoms, your skin crawling, you're sweating, and all kinds of stuff happening to your body. It's not just a mental psychological addiction, it's a physical addiction that makes you physically sick to get off of. And these people, they glorify drugs with the legalization of the drugs. You know, cigarettes, you're smoking cigarettes, your body's a temple of the Holy Spirit. It's not a good thing to do. The Lord says in Corinthians that you're going to have judgment as the result of smoking cigarettes. But cigarettes don't make you high, right? Having a glass of wine could make you, you know, can take some pain away, but you have to drink more to get drunk. But if you're smoking marijuana, you're doing this to get high. So I say all of that because Lot is not considering the spiritual environment he's going to. He's just looking at the appearance. And the school system where I live is a very good school system. But the spiritual environment, if the parents, what can I expect of the children if the parents think that's okay? It's not the children's fault, it's the parents' fault. So we go here, Lot chooses in this place that looks really nice. He chose for himself all the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed east. And they separated from each other. Abram dwelt in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelt in the cities of the plain. I tell you, I would never want to live in New York City. We are in here in the trenches of COVID. We're in the suburbs of New York City, but I would never want to live in New York City. Why? Because as many activities as New York has, it has tons of immorality. I remember I grew up in Ohio and in Virginia. My parents are immigrants, but I grew up in Ohio and Virginia. I remember coming to New York and being in shock. You go and you see pornography stores in the street. I remember coming to the bus terminal when I was 16 years old and we moved here. And there was a man naked in the bathroom, cleaning himself in the sink, and just smiled at me when I came in the bathroom. I left. I was in shock. So Lot is putting his family, he's exposing his family to this negative spiritual environment. I tell you folks, if you have some people, they live in areas that are like that, because they have to. But if you don't have to live in an area with a negative spiritual environment, ask the Lord, Lord, do I move to the next town over that's got a better school? Lord, do I put my children in Christian school to get them out of that environment? Do I go to the next county over? So that's very important. And that was Lot's mistake. He chose to be in that environment. If you see the kind of, you think that we have immorality in New York, we're going to see what kind of immorality you had in Sodom and Gomorrah. It was 1,000 times worse. 1,000 times worse. And it says here, Lot dwelt in the city is of the plain and pitched his tent even as far as Sodom. But the men of Sodom were exceedingly wicked and sinful against the Lord. They were exceedingly wicked. Genesis 19, verse 1 says, now the two angels come to Sodom in the evening, right? Abraham had prayed about Sodom and Gomorrah, interceded so that God wouldn't destroy those cities. And it said that two angels came to Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. When Lot saw them, he rose to meet them, and he bowed himself with his face toward the ground. And he said, hear now, my lords, please turn into your servant's house and spend the night and wash your feet. Then you may rise early and go on your way. And they said, no, but we will spend the night in the open square. See, Lot knew how bad this place was. And even knowing how bad this place was, he didn't go back to Abraham. If it were me, I would say, you know what? Maybe I should go back to Abraham. Maybe we should rethink about where we're, you know, where I can be and stuff like that. I don't want to raise my children in this mess. I've worked in the inner city for 20 years here in the New York metropolitan area. I tell you, God would have to write to me on a cloud to raise my children in that environment. Because what happens is, you could have the nicest home, you could be having the nicest morals in your home, but because there's a few bad apples in the neighborhood, they, you know, some boy could come and lead your daughter astray, right? I know this because I had students like that. That they were coming to my school, which was like the worst school in the area, and they were having relations at the age of girls 14 years old, 13 years old, 15 years old. They were skipping school with these young men. And I'm not saying that those young men are bad people, but I'm saying the environment. What kind of environment are you raising your children in? And so if you have to be in that situation is one thing. If you don't, get out. Get out. And Lot didn't have to be in that environment. He knew what he was dealing with because he says, he insisted strongly. So they had turned into him and entered his house. Then he made them a feast and baked unleavened bread and they ate. Now before they lay down, this is how we know that Sodom and Gomorrah was much worse than New York City, much worse than anything we're seeing today. Before they lay down, the men of the city, the men of Sodom, both old and young, all the people from every quarter surrounded the house, and they called to Lot and said to him, where are the men who came to you tonight? Bring them out to us that we may know them carnally. That's like if every single man in the whole town is obviously bisexual, and not only bisexual, but wants to rape every new person who comes to town. Gang rape them. That's tough. And I'm glad that my little one left the room for a minute. But this is the word of God. That's how bad it got. That's why God was like, you know what? Everybody's into this except for Lot. There's no more hope for these people. You know, because even if you say, well, what people do in their bedroom is their business. But when it comes to the point where they want to force somebody else and they want to do bad, they want to do something to you when you are not wanting to have that done to you, that's just evil. So Lot, and we know the Bible says that we shouldn't be doing, you know, homosexual acts and stuff like that or any acts outside of marriage. But the point is here, it's even worse when you're actually forcing yourself on somebody. And the whole town wanted to force themselves on these two angels. So Lot was in sin too. And I'm going to call it like it is. This shows how messed up Lot was, how his priorities were out of order. And we as parents, we as Christians, We really have to be careful with our priorities. Lot went out to them through the doorway, shut the door behind him, and said, "Please, my brethren, do not do so wickedly. See now, I have two daughters who have not known a man. Please, let me bring them out to you." Why would you bring your daughters to these people so they could hurt them? And I could be real graphic about it, but I'm not, because I do have a child who might be coming in the room. You know, why would you do that? If it were me, I would say, don't do it to them. If you're going to do it to somebody, do it to me. You know, I'm so grateful to God. I'm so grateful. I was praising the Lord last night. We always have prayer, my wife and my children and me. We always try and pray before we go to bed. And I was praising God that if somebody has to be sick in this household, if somebody got to be battling sickness, it's not my children, it's me. When you're a really good parent, when you try to be anyway, and I'm not saying I'm the best parent, but I try to be a good parent, you'd rather suffer than see your children suffer. So Lot was not a good parent. He wasn't. He may have been a righteous man, he may have had some good qualities, but he was not a good parent, because a good parent is not going to tell these people, "Don't hurt the strangers, hurt my daughters." So then, and they weren't even married. It talks about their husbands, but the son-in-laws must have been like the fiancés, because it says, "I have two daughters who have not known a man. Please let me bring them out to you, and you may do to them as you wish."
Wow.
The whole town, what, they could die. "Only do nothing to these men, since this is the reason they have come under the shadow of my roof." And they said, "Stand back." Then they said, "This one came in to stay here," so he's like an immigrant, "and he keeps acting as a judge. Now we will deal worse with you than with them." My point is I would have just said to them, "Look, you know, if you're going to hurt somebody, hurt me. You want to protect those visitors? Protect those visitors with your own self. Don't put your daughters in that situation. Don't volunteer other people to take a sacrifice. You take the sacrifice." So they pressed hard against the man Lot and came near to break down the door. But the men, these angels, reached out their hands and pulled Lot into the house with them and shut the door. And they struck the men who were at the doorway of the house with blindness. They had to make them blind so they would leave. Both small and great, everybody in the town, so that they became weary trying to find the door. They actually had to get tired out. They were going to do these bad things to these two angels. And to Lot. They didn't want women, they wanted men. That's why it's called sodomize. That's where this term comes from. Then the men said to Lot, "Have you anyone else here?" So the angels are talking to Lot. "Have you anyone else here? Son-in-law, your sons, your daughters, and whomever you have in the city, take them out of this place." I'm telling you, folks, if you're in an area where there's a lot of immorality, get out if you can. I know sometimes it's hard to, but if you can, get out. "For we will destroy this place because the outcry against them has grown great before the face of the Lord, and the Lord has sent us to destroy it." So Lot went out and spoke to his sons-in-law, who had married his daughters. I guess they were just recently married, because unless he was lying. So we see here again, he may have been just, but he wasn't 100% right. So Lot went out and spoke to his sons-in-laws, who had married his daughters, and said, "Get up, get out of this place, for the Lord will destroy the city." But to his sons-in-law, he seemed to be joking. Prepare the ark that God wants you to prepare. Pray for your children that they marry the right people. Because guess what, folks? Those people that they marry could either help to protect them spiritually and grow spiritually, or they could put them in spiritual danger. And in the case of Lot's daughters, their husbands put them in spiritual danger. They didn't take the things of God seriously. And of course, why wouldn't they take the things of God seriously? Think about the environment that they were brought up in. the things of God weren't taken seriously. So when the morning dawned, the angels urged Lot to hurry, saying, "Arise, take your wife and your two daughters who are here, lest you be consumed in the punishment of the city." And while he lingered, so he was in so much shock, and he was so, I think he was so bound up in the appearance of the city and where is he going to go. When God tells you, get out, get out. I tell you, my grandmother, my father's mother, Minna, right over here, I love having my family here on the, my church family, the leaders of the church, and my two grandmothers, and all my, most of my other close relatives, they're up here on the piano here. And my grandmother Minna, she was a refugee. When you're a refugee, whatever's on your back, that's what you take. I actually have flash drives because of that mentality that have all my pictures, or a lot of my pictures on them. And I said, if I ever have to flee, I got everything that I need here. I just go with the clothes on my back, my wallet, and my phone, and my pictures, and I'm good. So Lot is sitting there, and while he lingered, the men took hold of his hand. He had to actually grab his hand, his wife's hand, and the hands of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful to him. God could have said to him what he did to his sons-in-law. You know what? You're not going to come? I'm going to destroy you too. But because Abraham had a connection with Lot, and because Lot tried to help the angels, they grabbed his hand, and his wife's hand, and the hands of his two daughters. See, Noah could save his sons' wives. Lot couldn't. Prepare the ark that God wants you to prepare. The Lord being merciful to him, and they brought him out and set him outside, that he said, "Escape for your life." No, what is it? They brought him outside the city. So it came to pass, verse 17, when they brought them outside, that he said, "Escape for your life. Do not look behind you, nor stay anywhere in the plain. Escape to the mountains, lest you be destroyed." Then Lot said to them, "Please know, my lords," he actually is going to tell the angels, "I don't want to follow your instructions. Indeed, now your servant has found favor in your sight, and you have increased your mercy, which you have shown me by saving my life. But I cannot escape. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you." Philippians 4:13. If God tells you go to the mountains, go to the mountains. Hallelujah. It says here, but God was so merciful to Lot, he said, "Okay, you don't want to go to the mountains, I'm going to send you somewhere else." It says, "But I cannot escape to the mountains, lest some evil overtake me and I die. See now, this city is near enough to flee to, and it is a little one. Please let me escape there. Is it not a little one? And my soul shall live." So he's bargaining with God. And God is so kind, he says, and he said to him, "See, I have favored you concerning this thing also, and that I will not overthrow this city for which you have spoken. Hurry, escape there, for I cannot do anything until you arrive." Therefore, the name of the city was called Zoar. The sun had risen upon the earth when Lot entered Zoar. Then the Lord rained brimstone and fire on Sodom and Gomorrah from the Lord out of the heavens. So he overthrew those cities, all the plain, all the inhabitants of the cities, and what grew on the ground. So what had looked so pretty was destroyed. So you go to the city, "Oh, is this so pretty? All these lights, all these beautiful buildings." Folks, make sure that the spiritual environment is just as pretty as what you're seeing. Because if it's not, it's no good. But his wife looked back behind him. See, when God sends you in a direction, you shouldn't look back. That's what this is. Lot's wife, I believe God allowed this to happen to her because he wanted to teach us. When God sends you in a certain direction, don't look back. Because it says here, she looked back and she became a pillar of salt. Then Lot went out, verse 30. Lot went up out of Zoar and dwelt in the mountains. He ended up in the mountains anyway. And his two daughters were with him, for he was afraid to dwell in Zoar. If you ask God to send you to Zoar, why are you afraid to dwell in Zoar? It doesn't make any sense. And he and his two daughters dwelt in a cave. Now the firstborn said to the younger, this is a really sad story, folks. Lot is supposed to be a just man. He's supposed to be a man who knows about God, who does the right things. But listen to this. He didn't take his children into account. He didn't know what was going on with them. If he would have known what was going on with them, he wouldn't have fallen into this sin. Now the firstborn said to the younger, our father is old, and there is no man on the earth to come into us, as is the custom of all the earth. So they wanted a husband. The girls wanted to get married. They wanted to have children. And Lot's not talking to his daughters. He has them hidden up in a cave. He has them isolated. See, we can't do that to our children either. We can't lock them up. Who cares about her? Maybe one day they'll end up getting married. I don't know. But the fact is, she's not doing things behind my back. She's doing it in front of me. And that way, she's doing it the right way. Right? But in any case, you know, I could be the kind of person who said, no, you're not going to have any boyfriends. You got to be 18 to have a boyfriend. And then what's she going to do? She's going to do it behind my back? You have to know what's in people's heart. You've got to know what's in your children's heart. We're not going to be perfect, but we have to know what's going on with our children. And that could be your biological children. It could be your adopted children. It could be your spiritual children. Whoever God is putting as a priority in your life, know what's going on with them. So, these girls wanted to get married. And it says, verse 32, come, let us make our father drink wine. Why are you getting drunk with your kids? Why? He gets drunk with his daughters. It makes no sense. This is why God, one of the reasons why God says, don't be drunk. Don't get high. You know why? Because you lose self-control and you do things, inappropriate things that you normally would never do. And like we said, 1 Corinthians 10:12, be careful lest, you know, you who think you stand, be careful lest you fall. You got to be really holding on to Jesus to not fall into some bad stuff. The devil wants to destroy the people who are trying to live for God. If you're already in the world, he's not going to worry about you as much. But you're in the kingdom, oh, I can pull him down. I can destroy his testimony, just like he destroyed Lot's testimony. Come, let us make our father drink wine. What kind of environment did these girls grow up in? They grew up in a spiritual environment that was totally immoral. And that's why the oldest is thinking stuff like this. Come, let us make our father drink wine, and we will lie with him, that we may preserve the lineage of our father. Incest. God only knows what they saw in Sodom and Gomorrah growing up there. So they made their father drink wine that night, and the firstborn went in and lay with her father, and he did not know when she lay down or when she arose. He was totally trashed. That's what I'm saying about New Jersey. 70% of the voting adults voted in favor of legalizing marijuana. What are you going to do? You going to do? Get high with your kids? And then what's going to come out of that? It happened on the next day. And I'm going to say it like it is. Most abuse, molestation, and other types of abuse is not people, strangers. It's people that the people know. It's within the family. So don't tell me I'm going to go get high with my kids. You don't know what's going to happen when you get high. It happened on the next day that the firstborn said to the younger, indeed, I lay with my father last night. Let us make him drink wine tonight also, and you go in and lie with him, that we may preserve the lineage of our father. Then they made their father drink wine that night also. And the younger arose and lay with him, and he did not know when she lay down or when she arose. He was trashed. Getting trashed with his daughters. Thus, both of the daughters of Lot were with child by their father. What kind of testimony? His testimony as a righteous man is forever stained in the Word of God. Stained for all history. I'm sure he got saved. I'm sure he's in heaven. I'm sure he repented. But his word stained. Testimony stained. The firstborn bore a son and called his name Moab. He is the father of the Moabites to this day. And you know, God redeems. He redeems anybody. Because Ruth, one of the ancestors of Jesus, the earthly ancestors of Jesus, Ruth was a Moabitess. So a product of incest, it doesn't matter where you're coming from. What matters is your present and where you're going. Hallelujah. I praise God for his redemptive power in Jesus Christ's name. And the younger, she also bore a son and called his name Ben-Ammi. He is the father of the people of Ammon to this day. But you know what? The Moabites and the Ammonites in general, they were ungodly people. So what did Lot produce? Ungodliness. And it all came out of the fact that Lot did not know what his daughters were worrying about. He did not know what was going in through their head. Because if he would have known, he would have asked God for the courage as a father. He was afraid for himself. Well, let me have the courage as a father. Let me ask God, who supported me when he destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. He's going to support me to be able to either return to Abraham or move to a place where my daughters can get married and have families of their own. So as parents, we have to be involved in the lives of our children. Prepare the ark that God wants you to prepare. Hallelujah. You have to be aware of your children's situation. Even if that means you can't minister to that many people in the street or that many people, other people, but at least minister to the people in your own home. We have to minister to our spouses. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. I believe if Lot would have ministered more to his wife, maybe her head wouldn't have turned back. Or maybe if he would have said to her, honey, we can't stay in this place called Sodom. We've got to go somewhere else. She would have never had to die because she wouldn't have been in that environment. 1 Corinthians 7 verse 25 says, now concerning virgins, I have no commandments from the Lord, yet I give judgment as one whom the Lord in his mercy has made trustworthy. I suppose, therefore, that this is good because of the present distress, that it is good for a man to remain as he is. Are you bound to a wife? Do not seek to be loosed. There's nothing wrong with being married. Are you loose from a wife? Do not seek a wife. If you got that gift, not put in this verse, but it's in another verse. But even if you do marry, you have not sinned. And if a virgin marries, she has not sinned. So there's no sin in getting married. Nevertheless, such will have trouble in the flesh, but I would spare you. Married people, I'm going to tell you this. Just because you're married doesn't mean you're not going to have to battle lust. There may be times when your partner, you know, is sick and you have to have consideration. Maybe you want to do certain things and they're not able to, and vice versa. And that's very important to realize. You're going to have trouble in the flesh because sometimes you're going to be expecting certain things and it's not going to be able to happen. It says, but I will spare you. But this I say, verse 29, because if you're not married, you know what to expect. You know that there's no relations for you, period. Verse 29, but this I say, brethren, the time is short, so that from now on, even those who have wives should be as though they had none. You know something? Our focus shouldn't be on. And some people, they get caught up in pornography. They get caught up in lust because their focus isn't on Jesus. Isaiah 26:3 says, God will keep you in perfect peace if you keep your mind stayed on him. And if you're feeling that battle with lust or porn or whatever it is, I saw this wonderful movie the other night, Fireproof. The man had a battle with pornography. He threw his computer away. If you got to throw your computer away, throw your computer away. If you got to put a child lock on your computer so that those images don't come popping up, put the child lock. You know, they have those virus programs. They have those programs that only... That blocks certain things so they won't come up onto your computer. If you got to put the computer where your wife can see, your family can see, so you're not going to go into things that are inappropriate, do that. Whatever it takes. Get in the Word when you want to do something that's bad. Instead of getting, you know, fight the devil. Be a real man. A real man isn't a man who isn't defined by, oh, how many people you've been with. A real man is somebody who wants to do something but does the right thing instead. That's a real man. Hallelujah. That's a strong man. Hallelujah. You know, the only person I've had is my wife. The only person I've been with is my wife. And I got married late. And when I was in my 30s saying to people, oh, you never been with anybody? And they would laugh. I said, yeah, that's one of the ways I honor God. For the glory of God. So in any case, verse 29, you got a wife? It's as if you had none. Your focus isn't on, oh, I'm going to have this time with my wife or do this with my wife or that with my wife. You enjoy those times, but your main focus should be on Jesus. Hallelujah. Verse 30, those who weep as though they did not weep. Those who rejoice as though they did not rejoice. Those who buy as though they did not possess. That's not our focus, because guess what? Verse 31, and those who use this world as not misusing it. For the form of this world is passing away. Jesus said in Matthew that when the gospel was preached in all nations, the end would come. And we're almost there if we're not there already. So more than ever, the form of this world is passing away. Verse 32, but I want you to be without care. He who is unmarried cares for the things of the Lord, how he may please the Lord. But he who is married cares about the things of the world, how he may please his wife. You've got to spend time with your spouse. You've got to think about, oh, she likes to go shopping. So guess what? Sometimes I'm going to go shopping. He likes to go camping. Sometimes I'm going to go camping. It's not all about serving the Lord. You're serving the Lord by being with your spouse. You're serving the Lord by building up your marriage, by making it strong, by spending time together, sharing things together. Maybe it's something that you normally wouldn't do. I'm not a person who normally goes shopping. But sometimes I go shopping because my wife wants to go shopping. Here it says, verse 34, there is a difference between a wife and a virgin. The unmarried woman cares about the things of the Lord, that she may be holy both in body and in spirit. But she who is married cares about the things of the world, how she may please her husband. So you have to minister to your spouses, right? To your spouse, right? One person ministering to one spouse, right? It's Adam and Eve, not Adam, Eve, and Sarah, and Sally. No. You know, we have to minister to our spouses, is what I'm saying. We. So if it's you, it's your spouse. Our elders are also important. Okay, so we're talking about our children, especially our minor children, because they're defenseless. We're talking about our spouses, because our spouses were one flesh with our spouse. And God says, you can't just think about, oh, I'm going to church, and ignore your spouse. You know, church is a priority, prayer is a priority, but you also have to make time for your spouse. Our elders are also important. 1 Timothy verse chapter 5, verse 3. Honor widows who are really widows. But if any widow has children or grandchildren, it's not just about the children. Grandchildren should be taking care of their grandparents. If the parents aren't there, if the parents aren't doing everything they need to do, or if the parents need help, the grandchildren should be there. My grandmother Carmen was sick. My mother needed help. I didn't say, oh, it's her daughter, so she's going to do all the work. No. Wasn't like that. At one point, my mother couldn't take care of her anymore. She got too sick. We didn't understand about home health aides and stuff like that back in the time. In that time, so we felt we had to put her in a nursing home because she was too much for my mom to take care of. I could have actually stepped up to the plate a little bit more at that time. But at least when we put her in the nursing home, it was 4 days a week is my mom, 3 days a week is me. And actually, Reverend Juana, who you saw come up here and sing, she was so kind. She and her family, they would go 1 day a week. So it'd be 2 days me and 1 day Reverend Juan and Reverend Luis and their children. At that time, they were young children. And I have to say something. The Bible says God will give you family. He'll put you in family, according to Psalms. These people are my family. These people are family, were family to my grandmother Carmen. They treated her like family. So sometimes, like I was saying, yeah, it could be your priorities, your biological family or your adopted family. Sometimes that family is your spiritual family that's not blood, but God puts you together as if you were blood. And I say that because there were people in our family who were blood relations who actually did less for my grandmother Carmen for whatever reason. I'm not pointing fingers or not saying anything bad, but I'm saying they did more for her than the blood family for the glory of God. So it's children or grandchildren. We've got to teach our children to have a relationship. If the grandparents are there, you should teach your children that they are responsible not only for you, but for their grandparents. Let them first learn to show piety at home and to repay their parents. So when you take care of your grandparents, you're also repaying your parents. You're also honoring your mother and your father. Hallelujah. And I remember my mother would say to me and has said to me, I'd rather you do for your grandmother than for me. What you did for her was like you did it for me. For this is good and acceptable before God. Now, she who is really a widow and left alone trusts in God and continues in supplications and prayers night and day. So that's a real widow, someone who's left alone. Verse 8, I want to jump down because this is my main point. If anyone does not provide for his own, so you could be out in the street ministering, unless God writes you on a cloud and says you're going to be a missionary in India or whatever, even though your parents need you. Amen? Unless that's the situation where you're 100% sure that God wants you somewhere else. Guess what? It says, if anyone does not provide for his own, and especially for those of his household, and this is going back to the grandparents, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. So we got to teach our children. It's about you. When you get older, you take care of your parents. You take care of your grandparents if they're still around. Because if you don't, you're worse than an unbeliever. I like the story that Reverend Juana told me about one of her aunts. This woman had 12 children. And she could never work. She's not going to have a pension. And she told her grown sons, they were all sons, she said, the 30th of the month, each one of you is bringing me this many dollars. Well, in Chile, it's pesos. You're going to bring me this many pesos. And if you don't come, I'm coming to your house with a stick, and I'm going to beat you with a stick. Wow. And she would go to their house and beat them with a stick in front of the wife, the children, it didn't matter. And you know what? Those 12 men would line up at her door the 30th of every month and give her the money she needed to support herself. That's Bible. That's biblical. You look out for your parents. You look out for your grandparents. You don't just throw them away. We put my grandmother in a nursing home because we didn't know what we were doing. There's a lot of things we didn't know. But I tell you one thing, she got better care in that nursing home because every single day for the last 5 years of her life, I could count on my hands there were the times that nobody was there. Mm-hmm. If it wasn't my mother, it was me. If it wasn't me, it was Reverend Luis and Juana. Somebody was always there. I remember one time it was an ice storm. And I lived in the same town as the nursing home. And I skated to the nursing home. It was a perfect excuse to stay home. I said, no, my grandmother's going to have her visit today. And that's not to glorify me. That's to give an example for the glory of God. That you look out for your people. The Lord Jesus wants us to help strangers, especially the poor. That's very true. So what I'm saying is not to say you just help your family and you don't help other people. Proverbs 19:17 is an example of that. It says, he who has pity on the poor lends to the Lord, and he will pay back what he has given. I'm so blessed. Our church is a small church. We don't have a building right now, but we're a blessed church. Hallelujah. We just helped, for example, 7 children in Honduras in a remote village to have all their school supplies, backpack, stuff to write with, paints, everything they need for school, for the glory of God. And you know what? You know, we've been through so much as a church over the past, I don't know how many years. I've been in ministry like 20 years. I founded the church in 2011. Spanish ministry from a previous church that came out and we formed our own church. But you know something? A lot of times it's like you feel like you're on a little thread, right? Because you've been through so many things, so many problems, so many changes, so many battles within the church, coming from without the church. It's really tougher to be in ministry than what you think. But you know what? When you have a heart for the people in need, and our church is the kind of church, we don't just take the money and we keep it for ourselves. 10% of the money that is extra after we pay our expenses goes to our benevolence fund. And the purpose of that benevolence fund is to help people in need. We've had people come to the church, it's cold out, we'll put you up in a motel. We don't want you to be in the street. We don't have a building to keep you in, but I'm not going to let you die of freezing to death in the cold. So God has sustained us in the midst of COVID, in the midst of all of these battles that we've been through. He has sustained us. And why? Verses like this. He who has pity on the poor lends to the Lord. Hallelujah. And he will pay back what he has given. You know, so it is true God wants us to minister to other people too. And it is true that we should only obey those things that agree with God's word. You know, sometimes our parents may not know the Lord. Sometimes the people in our family may not know the Lord. And they think it's okay to do certain things. Or maybe they're babies in Christ and they think it's okay to lie. Or they think it's okay to cheat. You know, you have a tax return and they say, don't declare this, don't declare that. You know, you come out, you're making $50,000 and you look like you're making $20,000. Then you want to buy a house and you can't buy a house because you haven't put the right things down on your taxes. So there's always a consequence for whatever action that you do that's wrong. So Ephesians 6, verse 1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord. So I'm not saying you take care of your parents to the point where you're doing things that are not godly. I'm saying that you better make sure that mom and dad, if they're in need, they got something to eat. Mom and dad, they need a roof over their head. They're not in the street. Maybe you don't get along well with them, okay? And you can't live with them, but you make sure that they have a roof over their head. So some people, they don't care. But that's not, the point is you obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with the promise. With promise. That it may be well with you and you may live long on the earth. And we know there's always exceptions, right? There's some people, they honor their parents and they don't live to be that old. But you want to know something in general? That's your promise. That you're going to live long on the earth. And this, the other side of that promise is that if you don't honor your parents, you may not live long on the earth. God doesn't promise to give you long life if you don't honor your parents. Verse 4, it says, and you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition or warning of the Lord. So, I am not saying to you that you don't take care of, you don't try and help other people. But what I am saying is that God gives us an order, a general order of priorities. It starts with our nuclear family, right? My first priority is my minor children because they have nobody to protect them or defend them but me and my wife. So that has to be number one after Jesus. And our nuclear family, biological or adoptive. Your spouse is included in there because you know what? God says you become one flesh with your spouse. Our extended family. So your parents, your grandparents, that's the next priority. You got to make sure that they're okay the best you can. And it could be aunts, uncles, other people too in your family. I have a relative in Dominican Republic that in the past I've tried to send money to because they had to, the person's trying to take care of an elderly relative of ours. And there have been times where they had to choose between, am I going to have water in the house or am I going to take care of medication? Have a list of medications for the person because like they say in Dominican Republic, to get sick is a luxury. It's not like the United States where you got Medicaid. There's no Medicaid. You ran your insurance right out. Guess what? You're too old. You the insurance you paid for is gone. Now you have to pay for everything. So there comes a point where you have to make a decision. This is the list of medications. These are the most important. The other ones I can't buy. So there have been times when I've sent money to that person because, you know, it's your extended family. You've got to have a concern for my extended family. Church family. So that's the next priority, right? Because these are the people that you're linked to most closely. The body of Christ in general. So when people talk about my persecuted brothers and sisters, or we sponsor children, you know, our church sponsors a child in Ecuador. I sponsor a child in the Dominican Republic. The body of Christ. We pray for the body of Christ. The next level is humankind. Right? So everybody's God's creation, whether they've accepted Jesus or not. So we should show love to everybody, help everybody when we can. But remember, you're preparing the ark that God wants you to prepare. I'm not going to put the same energy that I put for my daughter that I put for somebody who's in the street. It's not going to happen. That's not God's way. Noah didn't save the people in the street. Noah saved his sons, his wife, and the sons' wives. Very important. And I'm not saying that God isn't going to use us to reach those other people, but we should make sure our priorities are godly priorities. We don't want God to say to us, we say to him, well, I prophesied in your name, I cast out demons, I did this, I did that. And he says, you didn't do my will. You did all of this stuff, but you didn't do my will. And you didn't do my will because your priorities were all off. You made an ark, but it wasn't the wood that I told you to use. It wasn't the materials. It wasn't the number of decks. It wasn't the size. You know, you made an ark that was 100 feet long. I told you to make one 25 feet long so your children would fit in. Now, I want to finish up. This proves my point, in my estimation. And I believe I have the Spirit of God in this. Mark 7, verse 5 says, the Pharisees and scribes asked him, why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat bread with unwashed hands? He answered and said to them, well did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written, this people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. And in vain, in an empty way, in vain, they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. This is why I have problems with churches that say you can't chew gum. What does chewing gum have to do with you being close to Jesus? And sometimes it's the Pentecostal churches that are the worst. You can't chew gum. You can't watch TV. You can't, you know, the women can't wear earrings. They can't wear jewelry. A lot of times it's against the women. You can't wear short sleeves. What does that have to do with your heart? It doesn't have nothing to do with your heart. Amen? All it does is keep people out of the kingdom. Because maybe that gum chewer, that person likes the gum chewing, and the way you told them not to chew gum, now they don't want anything to do with your church. Or you told that woman, maybe she's got a heart after God, she loves people, but you told her, you know what, you can't wear makeup. And the way you told her makes her, I don't want to come to church. We have to let God deal with people. Now, I remember there was a time, and I'm going to preach this because it needs to be said. We had our youth group. We went to the beach. And I'm the kind of person, they say in Spanish, you don't have malice. When I look at women, I'm not looking at your body and looking you up and down and saying, oh my gosh, look at this part and look at that part. No, I'm looking from here up. Because the only person I want to see the body for is my wife. That's it. Because I want my eyes to be pure. So some of the girls, they were young girls, they came in bikinis to the beach. And some people in the church who were like these people, they call them radical people in the sense that they're radical about certain things, right? Kind of like the Pharisees, the religious leaders. They're super religious. They criticize certain things, but when it comes to forgiveness, for example, they won't forgive. Right? You're looking at the little speck of dust, but you forget the log in your eye. Well, these people, some of them, they had a real problem. Oh, my God, they're wearing bikinis. I'm thinking to myself, I didn't even notice. And they weren't even bikinis. I mean, I could see if it was like a thong or something crazy. It was just a normal bikini, and they're young girls. So, I mean, I prefer one-piece suits for girls, too. I'll be honest with you, I think we should cover our bodies and things like that. But I'm not going to go crazy if a girl comes in a bikini. I'm not looking at her like that. Anyway, so Jesus is saying, for laying aside the commandment of God, you hold the tradition of men, the washing of pitchers and cups, and many other such things you do. So they're focusing on washing their hands and washing cups and washing this and washing that. He said to them, all too well you reject the commandment of God, that you may keep your tradition. See, and that's one area where I believe there's Catholics going to heaven, 100%. Mother Teresa, for me, I believe she's in heaven without a doubt. But part of the issue that I as a Protestant have with the Catholic Church is that they put tradition and the Bible on the same plane a lot of the time. And that's why I prefer to be in a Protestant church, because the doctrine, the teaching of the church is focused on the Bible. And, you know, that was part of the issue with the religious leaders, is that they're putting the traditions on the same level as the word. So he says, all too well you reject the commandment of God, that you may keep your tradition. For Moses said, honor your father and your mother, and he who curses father or mother, let him be put to death. Verse 11. But you say, if a man says to his father or mother, whatever profit you might have received from me, so you need my help, but whatever you would have received from me is korban. That is a gift to God. I'm going to give that to God. You know what? That's not a gift to God. A gift to God is giving it to your parents who need it. Don't tell me your parents need help and you can't help them because you're giving to the church. Because that's not God. Hallelujah. That's why I say in my church, and a lot of other churches probably wouldn't agree with me, but I say, you got a tithe. If you can give your tithe and also help your family who's in desperate need, I'm not talking about, oh, they need their nails done or they need their hair done, stuff like that. I'm talking about they need food. Like my relative in Dominican Republic, there have been times I've taken part of my tithe. I said, I can't give an extra offering. But part of this tithe is going to so-and-so because you know what? They need food to eat. And there's no food stamps. Amen? And there have been times this person has said to me, I'm so grateful that you sent that to me because you know what? We didn't have food. So I say that when you say, oh, you know, my family's in need, but oh, I'm giving that to the church. Unless God writes you in a cloud and says, you give that to me, I'm going to take care of your family. Because that's another thing that can happen. Sometimes you give somewhere else and God gives to your family. Amen. But unless that happens, guess what? Then you no longer let him do anything for his father or mother, making the word of God of no effect through your tradition, which you have handed down. And many such things you do. So I say all of that as part of this message. Prepare the ark God wants you to prepare. Have the priorities that God wants you to have. Those priorities, like I said, nuclear family, extended family, and that could be biological or adopted, spiritual family, right? Your local church. Then comes your body of Christ in general. Then comes humankind, and then comes creation in general. Because you know what? God gave us these trees and these animals and this earth for us to take care of it, not for us to destroy it. Amen? Praise the Lord. So I want us to prepare an ark right now. Because we know we're not going to heaven. And we can't take anybody to heaven unless we've accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. Oh, hallelujah. John 14:6 says, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by me. So guess what, folks? It doesn't matter how good of a person you are. It doesn't matter, you know, how religious you are. If you don't have Jesus as your Lord and Savior, what's his name? Hallelujah, Jesus. It's not Muhammad, it's not Buddha, it's not doing good works. It's Jesus. Jesus Christ, not Jesus Sanchez, right? And there's a lot of Jesus's in the Spanish community, but it's Jesus Christ. That's why when we have our passage of the day, our passage for today, that we send out in Spanish for my church, I always say, in the name of Jesus Christ. Not in the name of Jesus, but in the name of Jesus Christ. Because that's who I'm talking about. I'm not talking about Jesus Sanchez, Jesus Rodriguez, Jesus Santos. No, I'm talking about Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, he's the only way to God. The Holy Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, Jesus Christ, and God the Holy Spirit, because our God is one God and three persons. Hallelujah. And in that, our church, Protestant church in general, and the Catholic church, we are in agreement. It's one God and three persons, the Holy Trinity. Amen? That's what makes us true Christians. And following Jesus is what makes us true Christians. We're in agreement about that, a lot of us anyway. So how do we receive Jesus? Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. So you got to confess it with your mouth. It's not just thinking it, it's confessing it. And believing in your heart that God raised him from the dead. Amen? Jesus is alive. The Father's on his throne. Jesus at the right hand of the Father. And the Holy Spirit is the third person of the Godhead, the third person of the Holy Trinity. Lives inside the believer. Hallelujah. That's the one who's throughout all the earth right now, omnipresent, helping us all through and getting us to the other side. Amen. And Acts 17:30, I can't leave that one out. God wants us to repent, which means that you go away from what's bad and go towards what's good. And I say it like that because going away from what's bad means going away from bad actions, but also your words, your thoughts, your feelings. Going towards what's good is going towards good actions, thoughts, words, and feelings. Amen? So based on these scriptures, based on what we share today, hallelujah, I would like to say a special confession of faith with you all as we think about preparing the ark that God wants you to prepare. So please repeat with me. Father God.
Father God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For sending Jesus Christ.
For sending Jesus Christ.
To die in my place.
To die in my place.
And thank you.
And thank you.
For raising him from the dead.
For raising him from the dead.
Lord, I confess Jesus Christ.
I confess Jesus Christ.
As my Lord and Savior.
As my Lord and Savior.
Father.
Father.
Bless him.
Bless him.
To always direct my life.
To always direct my life.
More and more.
More and more.
Bless me.
Bless me.
To prepare the ark.
To prepare the ark.
That you want me to prepare.
That you want me to prepare.
To reach the people.
To reach the people.
You want me to reach.
You want me to reach.
The way you want me to reach them.
The way you want me to reach them.
And bless me.
And bless me.
To always be with you.
To always be with you.
And forgive me.
And forgive me.
For my mistakes.
For my mistakes.
In Jesus Christ's name.
In Jesus Christ's name.
I pray.
I pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Oh, Gastus Shambahur Namaniya Shonda. Oh, hallelujah. I feel the presence of the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Sometimes you just bust out in tongues, bust out shouting when you feel the presence of the Spirit of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So what we're going to do now, I have some prayers that I want to pray before we close our service. But before, I need to catch my breath a little bit. It was quite a message. Amen. But I feel that the Lord transmitted a special message to the body of Christ. And so I just need to catch my breath. So we're going to go ahead and take up our offering. Amen. And I just want to remind everybody the Facebook button doesn't work. But we do have Zelle, Cash App, and your money orders, checks, and also cash. All of the instructions for giving donations are posted on our Facebook page and also at our website under instructions for virtual services. And the website is, again, abundantlovechurch.us. You can also see past services on our YouTube channel. If you go to YouTube, the easiest way to find us is to go to youtube.com and then do a search under Iglesia Amor Abundante. So that's the easiest way to find us on YouTube. Our number, if you need prayer, you need a Bible, we just said a prayer of salvation for the glory of God. I feel like the Lord is going to touch somebody, then save somebody through that prayer of salvation, through the service. But if you need a Bible, you need prayer, the best way to reach us is to text us at the number on our Facebook page, or also on our website, abundantlovechurch.us. Amen. So without further ado, I'm going to give the microphone to Reverend Mary so I can just catch my breath. You all know that I've been following our services. I've been in a battle with the after effects of COVID. We are here in the trenches of COVID. But I'm just so blessed because by Jesus' stripes, I'm healed. My healing has not fully manifested in the natural. But what you have to see is that in the spiritual, hallelujah, you believe that you receive. Amen. And you'll have it. And it is mine in the spiritual realm. But I'm still battling in the physical, the natural realm. So I have to use wisdom while I'm in that battle. But you know what? Hallelujah.
Amen.
It's an example. It's an example to other people that when you're going through, you keep fighting.
Amen.
Hallelujah. In your weakness, God will make you strong. Oh, hallelujah. And sometimes I start to shout. I don't normally shout with this issue I'm battling with, but sometimes the Holy Spirit just shouts through me. Amen? So without any more delay, Reverend Mary's going to come and pray for the offering, and then she and Reverend Juana are going to offer up an offering song, and then we're going to finish out with some more prayer. Amen? God bless you, everybody.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for being with us. I want to thank everybody for being with us in this service, and may God bless everything that you do and everything that you learn today, because if we follow Him, we have salvation for sure, and that's the most important thing in our lives. And today, Lord Jesus, I want to bless this offering, Lord. I want to bless everybody that could give anything to our church. And those people, they cannot. Because the thing that we have to give the Lord is our hearts. But everything that God gives us, we should save a part for Him. Because it's to grow His kingdom. It's not for us, it's for the kingdom of God. And in the Jesus' name I claim everything that I say. Amen and hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus Christ, for being here with us and for provide for abundant love all these years. And in your precious name I claim, amen and hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. And now we're going to sing a song here in the honor of Jesus. And we will continue with the, we have a list of people that we're going to pray for later on. And the name of the song is Victory Is Mine. Okay.
Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I don't say get behind. Victory today is mine. Lord is mine. Lord. Behind, healing today is mine.
Praise the Lord, everybody. So I just wanted to close our service, or begin to close our service with prayer. So I just want to lift up these prayers to the Lord. Again, I praise you, Holy Spirit, for covering those things we don't know. Hallelujah. With our understanding, with your tongues. And I have some emergency prayers that I want to lift up. First of all, I want to pray for all the people who are my private prayer. Lord God, cover them all with the precious blood of Jesus. They're my private prayer list because they're people who don't necessarily want to be, have their names out there. But Lord God, we're crying out to you for them anyway. Hallelujah. I praise you, Holy Spirit, for covering them with the precious blood of Jesus in spirit, soul, hallelujah, and body. Hallelujah. Father God, I want to lift up to you the people in English, Lord God, on this emergency prayer list, Lord God. Hallelujah. I pray for the maximum blessing possible for all ministries, Lord God. Especially Compassion International, the Voice of the Martyrs, and Blue Mountain Christian Retreat, Abundant Love Christian Church, and Word of Life Christian Ministries. Father God, I want to cry out to you, Lord God, that you would cover with the precious blood of Jesus in spirit, soul, and body, now and always. I pray all of these prayers will be permanent prayers before you. Hallelujah, 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 that each time we pray them, they would just get stronger. But give total well-being, Lord God. Cover it with the precious blood of Jesus, the following people, Lord God. Pearl Mitchell, Lord God. Daku dika daku daku daku. Johnson St. Louis. Babu biba babu babu babu. My Uncle Bob. Kashashishamahoranamanihashonda. Jessica Smith. Daku dika daku daku daku. Daku dika daku daku daku. Judy and all the people in nursing homes. Kashashishamahoranamanihashonda. Nicole, the niece of Jessica. Hallelujah. And Jita. Gatu gita gatu gatu gatu. Gatu gita gatu gatu gatu. Marcy Davis. And all the people who are in her family who are battling in spirit, soul, and or body. Cover them in a special way with the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. That they would have the victory, Father God. Kashashishamahoranamanihashonda. Gatu gita gatu gatu gatu. Father God, we cover Janice and Chelsea and Jennifer and Julie and Ron and Zach and all of their loved ones and all of the neighbors. Hallelujah. Kashashishamahoranamanihashonda. With the precious blood of Jesus, because we know where the blood is, the life is, according to Leviticus 17:11. Hallelujah. And we know that where Jesus' life is, his light is, according to John chapter 1. And where his light is, the darkness can't stay. So we ask for permanent covering for Janice and Chelsea, Jennifer, Julie, Ron, Zach, all of their loved ones and neighbors. Father God, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. For my Aunt Marisol and for Carmine, Lord God, we cover them with the blood of Jesus as well. For everybody who participates, has participated, or will participate in Abundant Love Christian Church, together with their loved ones, hallelujah, their descendants, and all of their spouses, past, present, and future, we ask, Father God, you will cover them with the precious blood of Jesus and give them total well-being in spirit, soul, and body. And I pray, Father God, for a special covering with the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. For everybody involved in this intercession, bless us to always have the maximum amount of joy, the minimum amount of suffering. Hallelujah, oh, hallelujah. Father God, I pray that we would stand in the gap according to Ezekiel 22 effectively. Stand in the gap for our nation, the United States, for the nations of everybody watching. Hallelujah. This service. Hallelujah. For Israel, because our Bible comes from Israel. All of our nations of origin and all of our allies. Father God, please, hallelujah, we cry out to you, Lord God, that you will replace COVID-19 with spiritual awakening that lasts until the rapture, at least, so that the maximum number of souls is saved now and forever. In the spirit of Genesis 32:26, hallelujah. We don't let go until you bless us, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. So, Father God, I ask you to destroy all the idols in our nations that you revealed to me. Destroy those idols. Hallelujah. Knock them down and replace them with good things as much as possible, in the maximum joy possible and within your will. Destroy traditional idols, including images and every type of statue people pray to. Hallelujah. Replace these things with following Jesus Christ according to what the Bible says. Oh, hallelujah. Replace unbelief and doubt. Hallelujah, hallelujah, with always believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, hallelujah. Replace selfishness, Lord God, with always putting you and your priority of loving other people first. And as a result, replace prejudice with loving everybody the same, treating them equally well. Hallelujah. Replace, Father God, abortion. With increasingly better care of our youth and our children. Replace, Lord God, hallelujah, divorce with families that are happily united in love and in Jesus Christ. Oh, kashashisha mahorna mani hashonda. 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 Oh, hallelujah. Father God, every bit of hypocrisy, hallelujah, amongst your intercessors, remove it, Lord God. Bless us not to be involved or like these things that we pray against and pray for. Now we pray against, Lord God. Bless us not to like them or be involved in them, Father God. Oh, hallelujah. Remove the hypocrisy, Lord God. Remove the hypocrisy from your people, Father God. Oh, kashashisha mahorna mani hashonda. O kasusisha mahur na maniha shonda. 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 Father God, we also ask you, hallelujah, that you would forgive, hallelujah, and save anybody who's involved in these things. We want the sin to be destroyed, but not the sinner, Father God. Save as many as possible, Father God. Hallelujah. We're not here to be judgmental in any way. We just want people to be saved. We don't want our society to be destroyed like you had to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, Father God. Father God, destroy idols of addiction and replace them with total addiction to your presence and your word. Hallelujah. Kasusisha mahur na maniha shonda. 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 Please destroy perversion, Father God, and replace it, hallelujah, with only being interested in monogamous heterosexual relations within the marriage of two adults, hallelujah, who are not close family members. Daku dika daku daku daku. Daku dika daku daku daku. Daku dika daku daku daku. Father God, we also ask you to please replace the idols of violence and death. Kashashisha mahur na maniha shonda. Kashashisha mahur na maniha shonda. With a peace in which everybody life is valued, including the lives of the elderly and the terminally ill. A peace that eliminates sexual violence and domestic violence. A peace that eliminates the violence in our streets and in our schools. A peace, hallelujah, 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 oh hallelujah, that eliminates cases of brutality and corruption by the authorities, Father God. Kashashisha mahur na maniha shonda. Kashashisha mahur na maniha shonda. We praise you, Father. We thank you, Father. Hallelujah, for moving in power. Hallelujah, in our nations, Lord God, and for saving as many souls as possible. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. So I just want to remind you guys, I know this is being transmitted. The transmission of this service is starting February 21st, Sunday, February 21st. Check back our website, our Facebook at about 3 o'clock, and you'll see that there'll be a link. I'll have a link for our Google Meet, so you can join our teleconference prayer if you so would like to. Amen. We would love to get to know more and more people who are watching our services. And just pray with you, agree in prayer with you in person. Amen. Hallelujah. And with that, I just want to tell you that I love you in Jesus Christ's name. And Jesus Christ loves you so much, much more. Father God, we praise you for this service. Hallelujah. We praise you for this time in your presence and in your word. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Have a wonderfully blessed day.